Hey all you cats and kittens and all you non-binary fittens, it's your boy, DBiddles. Welcome to ChatBots. I feel like the name of the show and the images on screen are kind of self-explanatory, but in case they're not, and you're one of my new viewers, here's the skinny. I build robot toys and I talk about stuff. Usually I talk about my robot toy, and then I talk about something else. Hopefully the something else has some kind of connective theme to the robot toy. Hopefully it's not just something that only makes sense to me. Hopefully by the end I have a cool new robot toy, and hopefully we've all learned a little something along the way. Sound good? Cool, let's blast off. Following this formula, please note that we have entered the robot talkie portion of our content. So let me tell you about my boy Linebarrel here. Kuragane no Linebarrel, or Linebarrels of Iron, was a manga series by Eiichi Shimizu that ran from 2004 to 2015. But I ain't read that shit. I did, however, watch the anime series that ran for 24 episodes from 2008 to 2009. So, is it fair to judge the series based off only a partial adaptation that likely took a number of significant creative liberties? Is it possible, or in fact highly likely, that the manga is the better told story, and that this anime is at best a serviceable introduction to the manga series for potential new readers, and at worst a complete shambles? Should I probably read the manga instead? Should adaptations be judged based on how faithfully they convey the original's narrative, or should they stand on their own as an individual work that is officially inspired by the source? Bruh, I don't know. People judge single superhero movies based off characters with 80 plus years of continuity all the time, so whatever, we're doing this. And since we're doing this, let's do it in the style of a 1990s movie trailer. Koichi Hayase is a junior high student with a big problem. See, he's always getting picked on by bullies at his school for being a big dumb nerd and daydreaming about superheroes all the time. But his whole life gets turned upside down when a mysterious and pretty girl named Emi Kizaki falls into his lap. Nice. The only problem with that is that she was piloting a great big robot at the time and she literally crushed him to death. Ooh. Brought back to life by Emi giving him superpowers and tasked with piloting the Linebarrel robot against the forces of evil, can Koichi be the big hero he's always dreamed of being? You got this, Koichi! Or will his superpowers turn him...
Why are you so mean all of a sudden?
...into a super jerk? This fall, Koichi Hayase is... Linebarrels of Iron, coming this October from Funimation Entertainment.
So, yeah, Koichi Hayase, who is not to be confused with Koichi Hirose from JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, turns into Tobey Maguire from Spider-Man 3 after getting superpowers, and naturally he uses these to show up all his bullies, though sadly not with his hilarious swing dance moves. No, he just beats the hell out of them. And when his friends tell him he's being an asshole, he blows them off and gives them the old, "You don't understand! I'm different now! I'm a hero, baby! And no one's gonna push me around!" And this also manifests as him being really reckless and careless while piloting Linebarrel too. And it runs with this for like 5 more episodes after that. So I thought, oh cool, subversion of tropes, I'm totally down. See, while mecha is kind of a novelty to those of us here in the States, where most non-mecha fans immediately think of Evangelion or Pacific Rim, and then everything else they just kind of imagine as being like some shallow variation of the Monster of the Week Power Rangers model, in Japan, it's a whole cultural mainstay. You know how, like, everyone in the US knows what Scooby-Doo is and what a typical Scooby-Doo episode looks like, despite probably only having watched a few episodes on syndication, if even that? That's what Mazinger Z and Getter Robo and Brave Raiding are for them. So this, what if the pilot of the super robot was a total narcissist and a violent psychopath thing, would be like their version of Brightburn or The Boys or Invincible. Taking that line that Dr. Kabuto says about Mazinger in the first episode, "With this machine you can be like unto a god, or a devil," to its logical alternate conclusion. Koichi just assumes from reading manga and watching TV that a hero is just a guy with cool powers or an awesome robot who fights villains, and that his bravado and abrasiveness is actually just newfound confidence and the ability to dispense justice. He doesn't consider for a second that him being the good guy protagonist doesn't automatically mean he's justified in his every action or word. Unfortunately, episode 6 ends with Koichi's arrogance and bullheadedness getting his buddy killed after his friends have been pleading with him to stop being such a prick, and he immediately learns his lesson and reverts back to standard protagonist territory, with the rest of the series carrying on from there like any other post-Evangelion mecha shows that tries to deconstruct the genre. And I don't mean like one of the good ones like Razifon or Bokurano or Dieguard, but like one of the stupid ones like Devadazi or Argento Soma or Muv Luv Alternative Total Eclipse. And since you've just watched this kid spend a quarter of the series starting his villain arc only for his character to get completely reset to zero, it's not like you're rooting for him at that point. I don't remember much of what happens after that. There's melodrama and horny teenage antics and some bullshit about alternate dimensions. And hey, remember how Koichi got brought back to life in the first episode? Well, spoiler alert, so does his dead friend around the start of the third act. So unless you're some goon like me who has to compulsively watch every robot anime out there due to some unspeakable pact with eldritch forces from beyond the veils of space-time, probably read the manga or skip it altogether. But hey, at least it's a cool robot! Thus concludes the robot talking portion of the episode. The captain has now turned off the seatbelt light as we transition into the main topic. Feel free to move around the cabin or use the restroom at this point. The attendants will be by shortly with a refreshment cart. We will be arriving at our video's conclusion in about 30 to 40 minutes. Thank you for flying, ChatBots International. Hey, speaking of airplanes, I hope you all watched episode 4 where I assembled the VF-1 Valkyrie from Macross. Because in case that talk about Linebarrel didn't clue you in, today's video is going to carry on thematically from where that one left off. If you didn't watch it, first off, how dare you? You think I just put numbers on these videos so you can click on any old video of mine and start watching? Why do you think I keep an ongoing playlist of all my content in order? Plus new ones now for just the standard chatbots and just the Brick Edition episodes? We have rules for a reason, people. You don't just start at number 5 like some kind of wild animal. But I'll make you a deal. I'll briefly recap the ideas from that episode for the sake of this one on the condition that you promise to go back and watch all of my old stuff when this is all over, in order of upload, obviously. Alright? Alright, so here's the gist. I talked about how young men feel adrift and hopeless and worthless in their roles as men, and I pointed out that one of the contributing factors for that is how media, even from a young age, tends to reinforce this idea of men as warriors, as fighters, as police, as the guardians of civilization. You know, through superheroes and Saturday morning cartoons and video games and action movie heroes and anime pro tags, etc. And I spelled out how not only are warriors actually not necessary, or at least not ideal for a functional society, but that this mentality of tying force and violence to the identities of men is actually pretty harmful. I also pointed out that there are a lot of people out there who seem to want to capitalize on this phenomenon of aimless wandering young men, despite not having their charge's best interests in mind. And I suggested that more funding for public services and education and extracurricular activities are a great way to help put things into better perspective for the developing dudes out there. I definitely recommend you maybe consider watching that video first before continuing with this one, partly to boost my views, but mostly to give a fuller understanding of the ideas I'm trying to convey. I spent a long time building that thesis, there's only so much I can summarize here in a concise manner. But anyways, having epically debunked with facts and logic the notion of men as warriors, the question then becomes, so what does a man look like then? If being Kratos from God of War isn't the ideal standard I once thought it was, what am I supposed to be doing with myself as a man? What is the goal that my fellow young dudes and dude-identifying brothers should be striving towards? What does the self-actualization of a dude involve in practice? Well, fuck, I don't know. I'm not a philosopher. I'm not a developmental psychologist. I'm not an expert on anything, despite sometimes pretending to be. I've only been a father for about 5 years now, so mostly I've been focused on the basics. You know, like saying please and thank you, and toilet training, and learning the numbers and letters, and no, you don't need every goddamn toy that pops up on the television. And I kinda hope that none of you are coming into these videos having difficulty in any of those areas. If so, maybe ask your mommy or daddy to switch you back to YouTube Kids. You know, after you finish this video. And I can't exactly use myself as a model for what a man is supposed to be. It would be pretty vain of me to assume I'm doing this shit right, or that everybody should do what I do. Anyone trying to convince you that they have everything figured out and that you should think and act just like them, well, I'm sorry, but they're just a fucking grifter. The circumstances that made them who they are is unique to them. You can't replicate that. You're an individual. There's no owner's manual or strategy guide or player walkthrough for life. And yes, I also include religious texts in that. Your Bible doesn't exactly have any applicable tips for, like, dating in 2023 or composing work emails. Though it does have guidelines for buying and selling slaves, but I'm sure there's no reason to read too much into that. Anyone offering a one-size-fits-all formula for being a person is conning you. Full stop. They're not an expert on anything. They're just telling you what they would do, and are ignoring the fact that they could be doing this completely wrong. And why would you want to emulate me anyways? You don't know me. I could be really lame and ugly and stupid in real life. I mean, from what little I've revealed in my videos, all you really know is that I like playing with toys, watching cartoons, talking for way too long about nothing, and that I apparently have some kind of narcissistic need to film myself doing so and putting it up on the internet for other people to watch. So, I don't know, I guess let's just try some kind of inexact version of the scientific method and rhetorically test what qualities we need to make a man. We'll just run through a list of personal features and values that we tend to associate with big, strong, manly men, and let's just see if they are must-haves for being a whole-ass adult who knows what they're doing. Can you be a man without X quality? You know, must we be swift as a coursing river? Must we have force like a great typhoon? With all the strength of a raging fire, mysterious as the dark side of the moon. Come on, man, you had to know that that song was going to get referenced at least once with this premise. Rest assured that along the way I'll probably call out a bunch of dork stuff to help illustrate my points, and that by the end of it, I will confidently conclude my thesis with some poorly thought out broad statement that someone way smarter than me could probably deconstruct. Sound like a plan? Awesome, let's go. Number 1.
Deeds must be physically strong!
That's like one of the first things we think about when we try to imagine dudes, right? We just conjure up an image of a He-Man looking motherfucker with big old rippling muscles. Surely if it's like our go-to thing when we think of dudeliness, it must be important, right? Though thinking back to my Valkyrie video again, the emphasis on strength might be linked to that emphasis on force and violence that I kinda said was bullshit, you know? That's the whole premise of many a schoolyard debate about who's the best superhero.
Who would win the fight? Who's the strongest? Who can kick whose ass?
But I wanna reiterate that that's not an ideal version of masculinity and shouldn't be a quality to aspire to.
Well, surely you're not gonna sit there and tell me that strength is a bad thing, DBiddles.
Oh heavens no, viewer. You've got me all wrong. Being strong is a totally dope and cool thing to be. Big shout out to all my beefcakes out there. I know you all tune in for my show about playing with toys. That's totally what my analytics tell me, that I have lots of viewers and that the majority of them are Adonises. Physical strength doesn't have to be a force thing, though. It's good for doing work, for enjoying physical activities, for playing sports, for looking good. If I'm keeping it a buck with you guys, I kinda wish I was stronger and more cut. I definitely understand the appeal of being strong and fit. And if I'm keeping it a buck 50 with you, I've been kinda eyeballing stronger ladies a bit more frequently these days too. Women with big guns and cut abs are looking more and more appealing to me. I'm not exclusively into FBB types, I'm just saying, I have a broader aesthetic appreciation for the female form in all its various iterations. And you know, ladies like Rhea Ripley and Jade Cargill and Serena Williams and Autumn Ivy and so many others are just some fine specimens. Just carry me in your big strong arms, you muscle mommies, you. Sorry, no, dudes, we're talking about dudes. I think part of it, too, is that a well-kept body, to the minds of those who insist on it, is indicative of regimented discipline. It proves that you are capable of following some kind of plan, some kind of structure, and that you're willing to set aside creature comforts in order to attain that. But what's worth considering is that the time spent on that goal is part of your finite time on this mortal coil. The old, we all have the same 24 hours cliche. But like, the thing is, not everyone does have the same 24 hours actually. Some people work two jobs. Some people have family they need to take care of or spend time with. Some people have health problems. Some people have long commutes to work. And getting in shape requires time. It requires energy. And whether or not you want to admit it, it's helped in no small part by having lots of extra money. More money means more equipment, better nutrition, the ability to hire trainers maybe, or a gym membership. Having more money means maybe you don't have to take so many hours of overtime to pay the bills, don't have to spend as much time with little hassles that eat up hours of the day, don't have to choose between working out and leisure activities.
Bro, quit making excuses for your own poor life decisions. You don't have what it takes and you're coping.
Well, that's a stupid argument, because you're just making excuses for the validity of your way of life and the things that came easier for you. And it also assumes that the reward of strength and good looks is ultimately worth it. Maybe you live longer, but how much of that time is spent on working out rather than enjoying life? Maybe you look better, but it doesn't help you attract friends or loved ones if looks is all you've got going for you. Maybe it feels good, but it doesn't guarantee that you'll be as enriched by that time and money as if you'd spent it on something else. Maybe it impresses people, but it doesn't necessarily address your internal feelings of inadequacy if your body wasn't the core issue in the first place. Should dudes be strong? Should you not count as a dude if you're not buff? Should we need to be hunky muscle men in order to be considered men? Or are we somehow lesser if we're not cut? Well, again, it certainly doesn't hurt. It certainly has its advantages. If you've got that physique, or you want to aspire to that, I think that's cool and good, and I want to encourage you. But I wouldn't say it's necessary. We all agree that Jack Black's pretty cool. He's not exactly Charles Atlas. Dr. Stephen Hawking isn't exactly yoked either, quite the opposite in fact. But we all agree he's a pretty smart, worthwhile person. That's an extreme example, sure, but like, most of your fathers and grandfathers don't stay in their peak physical condition as they age. Even if they aren't all exactly feeble or flabby, even if they have the ability to hit the gym on the regular, they usually aren't keeping up on their lats and traps and delts. Not a lot of old men who look like Arnold Schwarzenegger out there. Hell, Arnie doesn't even quite look as much like Arnie anymore. He doesn't look bad, but he's not quite Mr. Universe anymore. Is that indicative of their gradual failings as a man? Are they somehow lesser because they're not as fit as they could be, or maybe as fit as they want to be? Are they less manly because they're no longer adhering to this strict regimen of maintaining what is supposedly a core facet of their masculinity? No, dog. Like, that's the thinking of someone who's made the gym their entire personality. Nothing, not even your most passionate interest, should be your entire personality. Making being strong one of your only qualifications for self-worth is both incredibly narrow-minded and very short-sighted. Manorexia is a term that gets brought up in these conversations. You know, when a dude is so insecure about his appearance that he's just constantly hitting the gym for hours at a time and starts incorporating whey protein and grilled chicken breast into every meal. What happens if you're in a car accident and you're left crippled in some fashion? What if you get hit by some degenerative disease that eats away at your body? What if your genetics just kind of make you incapable of building up much muscle mass or predisposed to being on the heavier side? What, you're now incapable of masculinity because of some trick of fate? Is your self-worth really so frail that it can be challenged by a love of Doritos or inescapable genetic misfortune? Even if you're not a Giga Chad Studley, it shouldn't really count against your man score.
Number 2.
Dudes must have epic ambitions.
They have to strive to be the best in everything they do, have to conquer others in their field of work, have to compete and be better than other people, have to dominate in their relationships with others.
That's a pretty conventionally masculine thing, right? We think of dudes, we think of being good at stuff. No, being great at stuff, being better than other people. It's not simply good enough to have skill or make money or be appreciated for your talents. You have to get on the leaderboard. You have to prove the validity of your talents by using them to prove other people's inferiority. Being a dude is apparently about impressing other dudes, making other dudes jealous of you, fully raw dog dominating other dudes, having other dudes look at your mighty, magnificent penis in awe and reverence and fear and envy and lust and... Wow, you know, the more I describe it, the more it kind of sounds like a kink thing, right? Isn't it weird how much this kind of thing is being done for the sake of impressing other people? Of making them think you're cool? Or of controlling other people to your benefit? Doesn't that sound, I don't know, kind of needy or insecure? Almost like you need the validation of other people, even those you don't really give that much of a shit about? Gotta have a cool car to impress the bros, gotta have big muscles to impress the bros, gotta have epic gamer skills to impress the bros, gotta be in charge to impress the bros. Bro, why don't any of your bros just like you for you? For who you are? Does their emotional guardedness prevent them from acknowledging your inherent worth as a friend and companion unless you can do cool stuff? Or does your insecurity make you feel unworthy of admiration and friendship unless you have some kind of talent that you can showcase? Are you afraid that if you're not the best at something, that you're not valid? Like you have to have a role in the squad as like the sniper or the tank or the healer or the brains or the charisma king or the explosives expert or something? And you can't just be like Neil, the guy who's fun to hang out with, or Jamal, the guy who always has something encouraging to say, or Irvish, the guy who tells great jokes, or Danny, who's just a real good listener. So much of this probably comes from living in a dog-eat-dog society, this capitalist world where you either eat or be eaten, you either get fucked or do the fucking. And so dudes think that since traditional masculinity dictates that they're supposed to be strong, supposed to be the sole providers and warriors, that they can't be vulnerable. That they have to be the one on top, that they have to be ever on guard for someone trying to usurp them and push them down lower on the totem pole, where they'll be the ones having to suck someone else's dick rather than being the one getting sucked off. But is that really a healthy mindset? To be constantly on the lookout, constantly paranoid of being beaten, constantly trying to subjugate other people, constantly holding back any sign of weakness? You're not made of stone, nor should you strive to be. Sure, stone can't be broken, but stone can't feel. Stone can't have joy. Stone can't know intimacy. And what's the point of being if you have to be stone? It's unrealistic to think that you can win them all, or even win most of the time. And there's no valor in dulling yourself to pain. I don't know. Maybe it is kind of an erotic or homoerotic thing for you. Maybe being in charge gets your motor running. Maybe being good at stuff gets you pumped up. There's certainly no shame in being a little more decisive, a little more confident, and a little more assertive than other people. And there's certainly no shame in feeling good and proud about yourself. Some people do gravitate towards that sort of thing. It can be a really appealing characteristic to have, romantically, sexually, and platonically, to be around someone who's sure of themselves and can take charge. So long as you're not being an asshole about it. So long as the people you're around feel respected and acknowledged by you as a dominant person. Because otherwise, you're just an obnoxious show-off or a bossy prick. If you need to be in absolute control of the situation at all times, if you can't stand to be viewed as imperfect or in some instances, incapable, if nothing short of perfection or a higher win ratio than everyone you know will do, then that might be the signs of some kind of neurosis or narcissism or insecurity. It's okay to be proud of yourself. To have confidence in yourself, to be passionate about something, and always striving to do better at that thing you have passion for. It's okay to want to work hard to achieve something, or to hone your skills at something. Being able to get a lot done, maybe more than others, is worth celebrating. Sometimes your skills will make you better suited for certain tasks. Someone with some quick-thinking organizational and delegational skills is great to have on a project. Being able to take point and coordinate how work and resources are managed is an important and useful thing to be able to do. But so too are the other people around you who provide that work and those resources. Certainly no less important than the person who coordinates it. If you have a coordinator but no one to do that work that they're coordinating, what you have is just one person who has to tactically manage themselves doing everything. And frankly, you can't do everything, idiot. There are just some things that you're not going to be good at that someone else is, and even if you can manage pretty good on your own, can get by on your own, you won't thrive as well as you will with the love and support of other people. No one of us is the equal of all of us. That's just math, that is. And right there, we run into another problem with this kind of sigma grindset thinking. Some people who've decided that their particular skill or privilege entitles them to dictate the lives of others, to dictate what others should be doing and how their success should be measured. Isn't it funny how we determine success based on, say, material wealth and fortune? Seems like the people who might have been born into that particular trait might be the ones who came up with that one. And isn't it funny that their advice is always something like, "Just work harder, bro. If you're not seeing the success that I, Jeff Bezos, that I, Bill Gates, that I, Warren Buffett, just happen to be born into, then you're just not grinding hard enough. You're just not getting up early enough. You're just being too lazy and selfish and buying too many expensive things that make you happy." It's kind of weird that we let those people who were born with a silver spoon set the win conditions for this life and therefore let them tell us what to do. It's kind of weird that the people who have the most to gain from us working harder are always telling us, "Yeah, no, totally, just bust your ass and someday you can be just as rich and successful as me." Life is hard and unfair sometimes, sure, but were we really just born to toil, to slave and suffer for the benefit of someone else? To be the stepping stone to their victory? To be the people who lose so that being on the leaderboard is special? If we exist just to suffer for someone else's gain, then what's even the fucking point? And of course, the only reason they get to do this at all is because someone a long fucking time ago stupidly decided that only people who trade shiny rocks or slips of paper are allowed to have the stuff they need to live. But that's another video entirely. Regardless, either you have inherent worth as a person, as a unique individual, or everyone has no value, and the only value is being arbitrarily better than other valueless individuals in categories that we just made up. I will accept no version of the theory that some people are special and then everyone else is an NPC extra in the stories of the special people. That's again just making up some bullshit to pretend like you have more value than the next person, which you do not. Number 3.
Dudes must have lots of sex with lots of beautiful women.
That's certainly a pretty traditionally masculine trait, being virile and conquering lots of desirable partners. Sitting atop a harem of eager women, all of whom crave your impressive throbbing cock and the hot, sticky semen pulsing in your huge, hairy testicles. Man, this episode's a really horny one. But hey, that's what they call it when you turn in the V-card, right? Making a man out of ya. Until then, you're just a boy. Until then, you're just some sad, loser virgin, some maidenless failure. Being a dude isn't something you can do on your own. It evidently necessitates the aid of a woman. I mean, females. And pretty ones at that. Like, has to be at least a 7 out of 10. If you do less than a 7, then you're just settling for whoever. You're just being a horny loser. Anyone can trick some desperate, ugly person into having sex with them, right? Oh yeah, did I forget to mention, you're tricking them, by the way. You have to be very clever and cunning to push the right buttons on the most desirable females to activate the sex dispenser. Because according to this joke written by some comedian from, like, I don't know, the 70s, females don't actually like sex, they just apparently trade it for getting to pair bond with the person who will financially support them. Any females just having sex with any old dude is malfunctioning somehow. Either daddy issues or trauma or stupidity, or they've caught the slut condition or something. A real man's man convinces the most beautiful virgins to sleep with him, and depending on whether he's going for Paragon or Renegade, he'll then either keep them and marry them or dump them for the next beautiful virgin. And you get double points if you steal a female from another dude. Double Renegade points for convincing the female to dump their soy cuck boyfriend, and double Paragon points for convincing the female to run away from their abusive shithead boyfriend. And once you've got your female, you're apparently just such a Mac Daddy that you rewrite the coding in the girl brain so that the sex pleasure circuit for her turns from inactive to active. But if that doesn't happen, don't worry, you're still entitled to the busting of the nut. After all, you're the breadwinner. You do your part, she must do hers, even if it involves something she doesn't like. Or else, you're gonna find someone who will attend to your manly needs. Now hey, look, I'm a sex-positive guy. I, too, enjoy the sweet ambrosia of the gods that is coitus. Life is hard, and there's a simple thing that can make it much less hard. See what I did there? And that simple thing is smacking button on your anatomy that fires off all the good neurons. You can't keep hitting the button forever, because there's a cooldown in between uses, and after so many uses you have to recharge. But I do think that one should aim to hit that petite mort as many times as they can before la grande mort. And nothing makes that button sing quite as much as getting someone else to help hit it with you. Partially, it's the actual physical sensation. Partially, it's the emotional and social validation of knowing that another person likes you enough to willingly touch your naughty parts. But therein's kind of the first point. It's a key word. Did you hear it? Willingly. I want all of my bros out there to have their button hammered like Chun-Li's lightning kick, as often as they want with as many people as they want. But only if my bros are doing it the right way. That is, with open and enthusiastic consent from their fellow adults of sound mind and judgment. Because they're not just females. They're not some species of wild animal or a resource that is desirable to have. They are people. They are individuals. Just like you. Despite my obviously facetious description, if you have to trick people into making a sex with you, I feel it's pretty self-explanatory how unmanly that is. A person should want to push your button because they are choosing to, free of any kind of duplicity or extortion. If you're having to pull the wool over their eyes, then you're just tacitly admitting that you're largely undesirable unless some sort of chicanery is involved to fool someone into thinking that you aren't repellent. Now, obviously, vaginas also enjoy the feel-good button pushing. It's just that their button's a little more complicated. Why else would there be an entire extremely lucrative industry based around crafting devices and mechanisms specifically designed for stimulating vaginas? It's because sometimes actual human anatomy isn't proficient in pulling off that combo. If busting a nut for penises is like Chun-Li's lightning kick, then achieving similar results for the vagina is kinda like pulling off fatalities in Mortal Kombat. It's different for each person, and the input's a little more complex and finicky, but it's definitely impressive if you can do it reliably. And vagina owners are very invested in having their fatalities. It just requires you to play the game a little to get them to that point. And also, there's lots of weird risks and social expectations surrounding women and their sexuality. I'm sure you've all heard the keys and locks analogy.
A key that can open any lock is a master key, but a lock that opens for any key is a crummy lock.
Because, you know, whole-ass people are comparable to inanimate objects. Hey, weren't you just comparing video games to- Shut up, you know what I'm saying. Look, in this house, we don't slut-shame. We slut-appreciate. And, like, the whole attractiveness thing is pretty arbitrary. I mentioned in my HiGog video that tastes can shift and differ and grow and evolve to encompass all kinds of people with all kinds of bodies. And there's nothing wrong with that. In fact, that's ideal. Can you imagine only liking a particular type of person? Let's say, white-skinned blonde women. And then, limiting yourself further by only liking particular body types and physical features. Let's say slim frame, adequate curvature in only the right places, no extra body hair, has vagina. And then, limiting yourself even further to those whom you like and who like you back, and then limiting yourself even further still to those for whom the mutual like is strong enough to want to make a sex with you. I know there's 8 billion people and counting on this earth, but like, you can improve your odds by being open to whatever life might present you. Though again I reiterate, so long as you're staying in the realm of consenting adults. Now, I mentioned earlier, I've developed a newfound appreciation for stronger, more muscular ladies. And I don't think that's indicative of some kind of subconscious weakness or a desire for men. If anything, convincing someone more powerful and more confident and more certain of themselves should be the bigger challenge, right? If you've got the game to make someone, quote, out of your league, want to play ball with you and have a good time, man, I'm using a lot of different metaphors here, then I think that shows some serious chops. Not that we should be thinking of relationships in terms of strats and stats, mind. But let's just say for the sake of argument that that was indicative of some kind of homosexual tendencies on my part. Okay, so fucking what? Are you gonna tell me that, like, I don't know, Neil Patrick Harris isn't a cool guy? Or that Sir Ian McKellen, aka Gandalf, isn't a cool guy? Or that David Yost, aka Billy from Power Rangers, isn't a cool guy? Or Stephen Fry, or Justice Smith, or Freddie Mercury, none of those guys are cool guys? You're gonna tell me that Kevin Conroy, the single best Batman actor ever, isn't a cool guy? You're gonna tell me that Benoit Blanc isn't a cool guy? We all like to make the joke that every single character from JoJo's Bizarre Adventure is gay, due to their, you know, flamboyant outfits and the poses that they do, and the almost palpable undercurrent of homoeroticism running throughout the series. Are you gonna tell me you wouldn't be okay being Rohan Kishibe, or Caesar Zeppeli, or Dio Brando, or basically everybody in the main cast of Part 5? You cannot convince me that Abakio and Bucarati are 100% hetero. Those boys is too pretty, too sassy, and too fabulous to not be at least a little bit bi or pan. And yet, they're still badasses. And as for those gender non-conforming folks out there, why don't you look up pictures of Valentina Sampaio or Trace Lizette or Laverne Cox and tell me you wouldn't at least consider buying what they're selling if, hypothetically, they may be offered to you. And you know, some people really struggle with this sex thing. Man, I get it. It's really hard because even though you're a person, everybody's weird and complicated and difficult to understand, and there's no player's guide game walkthrough for dealing with so many completely unique individuals in all kinds of different circumstances. It's totally okay if it takes you a long time to get to the point where someone will make a sex with you. That's totally fine. I'm fully convinced that if society hadn't been structured for thousands of years in such a way that women weren't allowed to own property or have a job or a bank account, a lot of our dads and granddads and great-granddads and so on probably would not have had the riz to get married when they did, if at all. And I know I'm saying this from my privileged position of being already married with a pretty great intimate life, but it can happen for you, and you do deserve it. You just, you know, gotta keep at it, man. Now this is another video entirely, but there's stuff you can do to improve your odds. Good, wholesome, totally legit stuff that will give you more opportunities and give you a halfway decent chance, even if you're not a 7 or a 6 or even a 5 out of 10. Though, that assumes you even want to have a relationship. Maybe you don't. That's fine too. I know a couple guys who probably would have been a lot happier if they'd decide earlier on to fly solo. Just do what's best for you. Number 4.
Dudes must like dude stuff!
I mean, this is ingrained in us pretty early on, right? You'd go to the toy store, you know, back when stores dedicated exclusively to toys were still a thing. I'm really showing my age by having nostalgia for Toys R Us and KB Toys and the like. Anyways, you'd go to the toy store and you'd run through the aisles, taking in all the sights of wonderful plastic trinkets, row after row, lane after lane, Legos, Hot Wheels, action figures, Nerf and Super Soakers, the sports equipment, the bikes, the video games, the books, the trading cards, the board games. But even here in this child's paradise, there were sections you dare not venture into. There was baby and toddlers. That was obviously not exactly stimulating to you anymore. And then there was the pink aisles. The aisles dedicated to all the Barbies, the Disney princesses, the baby dolls, the Care Bears, etc. Blech! Not for you, right? Boys don't play with that stuff. But I mean, some of that stuff looked kinda cool, though. Easy Bake Oven? That's pretty rad, makes desserts. Barbie's Malibu Dreamhouse? That might actually be a cool hangout for your G.I. Joes. Skydancers? I mean, that's a neat toy. Or She-Ra? Hell, that's just more He-Man toys. Or maybe you just unironically really admired how the Bratz dolls carried themselves with their confidence and poise and great fashion sense and slight hint of attitude. But no, stop. Boys don't play with those things. And then you get a little bit older, enter adolescence, and things shift just a little bit. Maybe you heard it from an adult, maybe you heard it from one of your peers. But it always came in some cutting observation. Dude, you still play with Pokemon? Bro, you still watch cartoons? What are you doing with that Spider-Man shirt on? Aren't you a little too old to be playing video games? You're how old and you're still obsessed with dinosaurs? Grow up, man. You didn't even realize that you had gotten to the point where you weren't supposed to like something anymore. It just happened without you even noticing, but someone else did, and now it's obvious to everyone, and now there's all these expectations. Dudes like sports. Dudes like cars. Dudes like guns. Dudes like eating meat and drinking beer and pretty girls. Dudes like action movies where no one is a superhero. Dudes don't like this new music. Dudes like the old music. Dudes like power tools, fishing, hunting, and pumping iron. Isn't it kind of weird how we end up letting other people decide what's okay for us to enjoy? Or more accurately, letting our fathers decide what's okay for us to enjoy. Yeah, let's just cut to the chase here. The people who get to be the arbiters of masculine taste are the grumpy old dudes who sure don't seem to be having much fun or enjoying a whole lot of anything anymore. And that's always just so fucking dumb because it's constantly changing with each generation, despite them insisting that it's rigid and immovable and absolute. Somehow, me building robot toys is totally different from all the dads and granddads who play with model trains or assemble model airplanes.
Dudes like rock and roll music.
Really? You think your granddad who listened to early rockabilly and disco was super thrilled with all these heavy metal bands where the musicians had long hair and makeup and tight pants and flamboyant personas? You think your great-granddad who listened to jazz wasn't put out by the Beatles or Elvis or Little Richard with their hippie attitudes and sequin costumes and sensual dance moves? You think your great-great-great-granddaddy wasn't pissed off at all these young people going to speakeasies where colored boys played sinful saxophones while women with short skirts and feathers in their short hair were dancing with any man they fancied? And nowadays, kids are listening to pop stars and dubstep and lady rappers, when back in my day, we had nu metal and grunge and early hip-hop. Pretty hard to keep track of what's manly when it keeps shifting with each generation.
Oh, well, you know, sports. Nothing more masculine than competition.
Bro, do you know what manly competition used to be? It wasn't a bunch of grown men getting paid fabulous salaries to play backyard children's ball games on television with a bunch of protective equipment to keep you from getting concussed too much. It was pitched fucking combat in an arena with live fucking steel and the crowd baying for your blood, and who lived and who died was determined by whomever was the favorite of the fickle emperor's fancy. You didn't get to retire comfortably because you tore your ACL. You fuck up, and the other guy takes off your fucking head. I bet there were a lot of pissed off grandfathers when they started the Olympics and the losers of each game weren't getting fed to lions and the winners were getting gold laurels.
Oh, they just give anyone who can run real fast a trophy, huh? In my day, you went off to war, and if you came back alive, you got a plot of land and a few cattle, and that was it.
Cars? Cars are a pretty manly hobby.
Yeah, sure, bro, cars. I totally can't imagine some grumpy old man looking disapprovingly at a Ford Model T while saying something like,
young people these days are so lazy, wanting to get into town on some newfangled contraption rather than learning how to ride a horse. Getting from point A to point B without having to tame and break the will of a wild animal first. Without having to bother saddling it and shoeing it and feeding it. You don't even have to clean up its shit. I bet even a woman could operate one of these confounded machines. No thanks. I'll stick to old Bartholomew. He doesn't make near as much a racket.
And nowadays, what kind of shit do you hear?
Kids today don't know how to drive stick shift. Kids today, with all their TikToks and Fortnites, taking pictures of their food and smoking vapes. Back in my day, we learned to drive in some diesel-powered piece of crap. We watched unskippable commercials and played video games that were almost impossible to beat. And we had to smoke Marlboros and wait for our pictures to develop at the drugstore. So we only took pictures of important things.
The more things change, the more we romanticize a past that probably doesn't deserve it. There's nothing wrong with liking your old stuff, or even with liking stuff from before your time. There's nothing wrong with preferring all that old stuff either. Just remember that it's your stuff. It's yours by virtue of it being the stuff you had on hand when you were young and times were less complicated for you, and that it's nostalgic for you. But it doesn't really mean anything to the people who were born later. So, what, are we just not allowed to make new stuff? Is that new stuff not allowed to be radically different? Should all children for the rest of time be forced to watch the same Looney Tunes, Mickey Mouse, and Tom and Jerry cartoons generation after generation because they were good enough for you, and so how dare they like Bluey and PJ Masks instead? How dare young people play video games instead of going outside to drink from the hose and skin their knees? How dare they not spend their lazy afternoons throwing rocks at trains or doing jigsaw puzzles or filling out Mad Libs or playing with an Etch-a-Sketch or having teenage pregnancies?
How dare some of them want to cook despite having penises? Cooking's for girls! How dare they want to paint despite having penises? Art and creativity is for girls! How dare they want to plant flowers despite having penises? Agriculture is for girls. How dare they want to wear dresses and makeup despite having penises? That stuff is specifically genetically engineered to be used only by those born with vaginas. How dare they? Why, back in my day...
Cooking for a family is traditionally a woman's duty. But tell that to Gordon Ramsay or Guy Fieri or Bobby Flay. You don't typically think of men when it comes to women's fashion, and yet, all the hottest fashion models crave Louis Vuitton or Giorgio Armani, brands named for the men who pioneered them. Everyone's all bent out of shape about biological males wearing women's clothing or passing themselves off as ladies, and yet, Shakespeare's acting troupe was exclusively men, even all the parts that called for women. Hey, you know, Tom Holland? AKA Spider-Man? He moonlights as a drag queen and his girlfriend Zendaya attends his shows. The color pink was originally marketed as a color for men. And Barbie dolls were originally saucy novelty gifts primarily targeted towards men as the equivalent of something you might purchase from Spencer's. And hell, we're living in the age of Barbenheimer right now. How fucking crazy is that? Don't fall for this stupid, grandpa-brained bullshit. Just because you are old and like old things and are out of the loop on what the kids are into, that doesn't mean that their shit is any less valid than yours. Your shit isn't special. You aren't special. I mean, that's really the heart of it, isn't it? All these traditionally masculine characteristics are just dudes trying to make themselves feel special based on arbitrary criteria that they and they alone care about. It's not enough to be a dude. You've got to be THE dude. You've got to be a very special boy. can't just be an individual. The masculine ego is so fragile that unless it's excelling while others fail, that it itself feels like a failure.
How do I know I'm a real man unless I do some real man shit?
But that's just it, man. It's all ego. It's all made up. It's all arbitrary. What, do you think men naturally have an inclination to sports cars? You know, the sports car gene? I talked in my Valkyrie video about how I reject the argument that any of this is natural. It's not a natural thing. It was trained into you by someone who didn't think you were good enough. They didn't think you were good enough because they didn't think they were good enough. So to make themselves feel better, they had to tear someone else down and build themselves up by building you up in their image. Maybe they were afraid if you weren't man enough that it would reflect poorly on them. Or maybe they were just ashamed of how they turned out, and they wanted to fulfill their ambitions of real masculinity vicariously through you. Or maybe they just saw you as a symbol of their own age, of their waning relevance, and your youth meant that you'd be the inheritor of their world when they got a little older. And they figured that they should shape the world via you into what they thought it should be rather than let you have any agency in what you want to do with yourself. Kinda like how dudes disregard what females want or feel. How does it feel to be the lucky recipient of someone else's insecurity? You're just a young person trying to live your life and have fun, and all the men around you are telling you that you're doing it wrong, and that you're not shit, and that they've got it all figured out.
Well, I can do more push-ups than you. Well, I have more money than you. Well, I have a hotter girlfriend than you. Well, you like dumb stuff. Well, my cock is bigger than yours.
And boy, doesn't that attitude just portray some real small man energy? And why do they feel that way? Well, it's because someone else did the same thing to them. They got old, and they got jealous that all these young people had so much more time ahead of them, that all these young people had it better than them. And so they had to pretend like they and their lives were somehow way better, and that all these whippersnappers just weren't doing it right. You remember that whole alpha male thing that was big in all the shittiest circles of the internet and in men's rights talking points as a hypothetical pinnacle of very special boy? Isn't it funny how all of a sudden there's this new version called Sigma Males, where you don't have to be Mr. Giga Chad Patrick Bateman, and instead are free to like Warhammer and Skyrim, but you're still a highly desirable and totally cool and valid very special boy? But being a beta male still means you're a loser soy cuck, and being an omega male still means you're like some cannon fodder chattel slave NPC. You don't want to be one of those, do you? Also, pretty funny how the only way you can measure which of those you are is by the opinions of your peers, who are all also looking to be Mr. Very Special Boy and are looking for any perceived weakness by which they can judge you as insufficiently alpha.
So come on, DBiddles. What makes a man? What are the qualities I should have? You've been on and on about this, and we're no closer to figuring out what a man is. It's almost like you don't have a concrete answer for what a man is.
Yeah, dog, it's almost like that. It's almost like I'm trying to communicate that this whole be a real man thing is an exercise in futility. You will never be good enough for the be a man crowd, because most of them are pretty miserable and fickle. Or they're preying on your insecurity. You ever notice how many of the dudes on the net who stress the importance of being a man have some kind of cure to sell you? A book, a course, a supplement, a Discord server with a subscription fee, a lifestyle change that just so happens to conform to a political agenda?
You too can be a man, you just need to get Brainforce Plus to help you fight back against the globalists.
You just need to read my book, 12 Rules for Life.
You just need to enroll in Hustlers University and buy a Bugatti.
You just need to wake up at 4 a.m., work out for 2 hours, and then bust ass at work and put in lots of overtime.
You just need to fight back against all these people attacking traditional masculinity with their queer socialist agenda.
You know what else I noticed about these guys? They all seem miserable. They're all single or divorced or angry or bitter or hateful or weak or just generally pathetic. And funnily enough, Not one of them are lumberjacks or firefighters or construction workers or Purple Heart veterans or Alaskan king crab fishermen or any of that. They're just a bunch of rich kids who've made careers out of shitposting. They're shitposters. Some of them go to the gym more regularly than others, but they're still just shitposters. That's their claim to masculinity right there, being rich and shitposting. I mentioned this again last episode, but so much of this insecurity stems from things like financial hardship, loneliness, depression, aimlessness, and uncertainty. I mean, after all, if you had a girlfriend, or had financial security, or had people in your life who really sincerely cared about you and supported you, or had a devoted goal in life, or were happy and well-adjusted, would you really care about being a real man? No, of course not. You wouldn't need to feel special. If your needs were being met, you wouldn't need to prove yourself to other people. It's okay to want to do better and be better. Being better might help you achieve some of those goals, but some of it might just be how you approach the world. The people who try to sell you masculinity know full well that your problems will never be solved by their solutions. They know that working harder at a dead-end job isn't going to get you fabulous wealth. They know that their dick pills and pickup routines aren't going to get you a girlfriend. Because if it did, you wouldn't need to buy their shit anymore. If anything, their shit might be designed to keep you in that unhappy and insecure state. It's designed to repel people and keep you slaving in some dead-end job that overworks and underpays you. But when their stuff doesn't work, they can just tell you you're not doing it right. Maybe you're jerking off too much, maybe you're playing too many video games, maybe you're just not serious enough. Just pay me $70 to come to my seminar, and you'll be back on track. I don't know, maybe it's time we break the cycle of insecurity with some wholesome and positive masculinity. If I were to suggest some qualities that I thought actually were important to being a man, I'd say stuff like being kind, being friendly, being honest, being helpful, being passionate, being true to yourself, being open-minded, having a good sense of humor, being brave, being loving, being curious, being confident in a way that isn't arrogant, while being humble in a way that isn't self-deprecating. All of that is on my list of cool guy qualities. There's definitely things you can do to have an easier time in life, and maybe we'll go over some of that in another video. But you'll notice a lot of this stuff is about developing better social skills and being a better, more likable, more happy and fulfilled individual. And it's all free, bro. It's all free. But it's a little more nebulous and difficult to master than reading a fucking book and buying a Bugatti and going to the fucking gym. You have to, like, think through this shit. Real women, real people in general, would much rather date or would much rather hang out with Pedro Pascal over Andrew Tate. Yeah, some of that is Pedro being a very successful actor in a lot of popular TVs and movies, but a lot more of that is because he just seems like a cool and friendly dude. Whereas the kickboxing champ, the chess master, the millionaire playboy who is Andrew Tate, is just a self-centered, judgmental, dick-brained asshole who only cares about flaunting his lavish lifestyle to impress teenagers. And that's even before you account for his many alleged crimes of human trafficking, assault, and abuse. Aren't you impressed, dudes? He's got lots of cars and lots of muscles and fucks lots of girls and smokes lots of cigars and talks mad shit all day every day about how great he is and how everyone who doesn't like him is out to get him because they're just so jealous. And for $50 a month, you can learn to be just as cool as him. I ain't got nothing to sell, man. That's how you know I'm genuine. I mean, if you wanted to throw some money at me via the Ko-fi link in the description, I'd be much obliged. But I do this for free, too. There's no price of entry for this ride. And do I have stuff I'd like to convince you of? Absolutely. But none of that has any impact on your validity and identity as a person. I can't tell you how to be a man because most of the best advice will be to you personally as an individual. It'll be unique to your life and your circumstances. I can give you broad advice. Is working out and being fit good? Is having lots of money good? Yeah, sure, broadly speaking. You know what else is good? Eating pizza. But I'm not prepared to prescribe pizza as a lifestyle to you. If you want to make pizza part of your whole lifestyle, go nuts. But I'm not going to say you have to incorporate pizza worship into your identity if it doesn't fit your lifestyle. Being rich and having big muscles and a cool car is totally chill, but for some people, for a lot of them really, it's either not feasible or not really at the heart of their personal issues. This whole man thing is just something we made up. I mean, are there biological components to being born male? Sure, but they're not really hard and fast rules. Some males are naturally smaller or less physically capable than some females, despite the trend being that they are larger and more physically inclined. Some females are better at STEM fields than most males, despite the trends. But everything else? Wearing pants, watching football, being a CEO, slaying lots of pussy, all those manly things? It's just a bunch of made-up nonsense. Being traditionally masculine is fine and cool, but it doesn't really make you a man. And if being a man is totally made up, maybe so too is being a woman. There's no law of nature that inclines women to dresses or makeup or passivity or the color pink. We made it up! Maybe this whole gender thing is just a bunch of bullshit too. I mean, there's penises and there's vaginas, but all the rest? Maybe that's just up to the individual. Maybe since you don't have a choice which one you're born with, what body you're born into, maybe you should be allowed to choose whatever part of your identity you want to adopt. The stuff you can choose should be up to you. You'll notice that my list of cool guy qualities is all stuff that's cool for everybody to do, regardless of gender. Just like it's pretty rad and cool if anybody has any of those typically manly qualities too. You know, being strong, being competitive, being sexually active, liking stuff. And if you're lacking some of those masculine qualities, you're still cool, man. You're just a different kind of cool. You're an equally valid, though totally different, flavor of cool. There's no one-size-fits-all for being a person. You're not special. Nobody is. Not any more so than anybody else. If nobody's more special than anybody, and there's no checklist to what you have to be, maybe all you can do, maybe all you should do, is just try to be the best and happiest version of yourself you can be. Hey, thanks for watching another one. I covered a lot of stuff and said a lot of things. Hope it all made sense and that you got something out of it. I'll definitely be coming back to the subject of dudes and the nature of their dudeliness again sometime. Please be sure to do all the things that boost me in the algo. Liking, commenting, subscribing, sharing, hitting the notifications bell, sacrificing a goat to the blood gods, etc. And hey, if you haven't yet, check out my other videos. Got a decent amount of them now, and I've got a whole lot more content percolating in the old noggin just waiting to get poured out for you. Hey, how did you like the Brick Edition videos? I definitely plan to do more of them. I probably won't tease them like I do with the standard ChatBots episodes. They'll just kind of pop up whenever I got enough little ideas to fill a short video. Would be cool if I could make them as regularly as I do the full ChatBots episodes. Like, you know, alternate them every couple weeks. But no standard schedule for anything right now. Hey, Guy King. Guy King's the next bot to get chatted. Here he is. Doesn't he look cool? This is DBiddles from ChatBots, and until next time, adios, amigos.